When we start talking about macroeconomics, we're changing our focus from smaller picture issues to larger picture issues. We start talking about things in terms of what affects the entire country, or perhaps the entire globe. Within macro, there are three basic concepts that we need to understand in order to get a grasp as to what we're looking at in macro. One of those things looks at production. When we measure production at the macro level, we're measuring something called gross domestic product, which is the value of all of the things that are produced in a country over a given period of time. You can pretty much think of this as price times quantity, but we're taking the general price level and multiplying it times all of the things that we produce. Well, that's fine, but it does lead us to one significant measurement problem, and that is there are now two things that can increase GDP. One is that we can increase GDP by increasing productivity, increasing how much we produce, which is what we really want to measure. But GDP can also increase if we increase prices, even if we don't increase the amount of things that we produce, and that's a problem for us. So when we look at GDP, we split it into two areas. We look at real GDP, which is what we really want to know, and that is how much output are we producing, and how much does it change? The other way of looking at GDP is through nominal GDP, which is just the GDP in a given year. The problem with nominal GDP is that while it's easy to collect, it includes any changes in price that may occur. And so if we measure things just in nominal terms, we might be capturing price changes and not output changes. Real GDP adjusts prices to keep them constant so that we can measure actual output changes rather than price changes. The second thing in macro we want to look at is how many people are working, or more commonly known as unemployment. Unemployment is a little bit tricky because it doesn't necessarily include people who are not working. It includes people who are not working but want to work and are actively searching for work. Usually, the higher the levels of unemployment, the less output is being produced. So when it comes to policy decisions, unemployment is a very important thing. The unemployment rate, which is the number we typically hear in the news, is the number of unemployed people divided by the labor force, or the people who are actually out there working or trying to find jobs. Unemployment rates can change for a number of different reasons. It can change because there are fewer people working, or it can change because there are fewer people looking for work. So we have to be careful about how we judge that number, but it's an important number at the macro level. The third thing we look at is what's called inflation. Inflation is the sustained increase in the general price level, which means essentially that if we have inflation, prices as a whole are on the rise. And this can be very destabilizing for an economy because people typically don't have their wages change as quickly as prices change. So if inflation is on the way up and you get a raise once a year, you may find that the wages that you make are not sufficient to cover any price increases. So this can become a problem. When we look at macroeconomic policy, the policy is designed to try to create some sense of economic stability. Economic stability basically means that we have sustained growth, which means real GDP is climbing, that unemployment is manageable. It doesn't mean that we have zero unemployment, but we have full employment. A certain percentage of unemployment is totally acceptable. And finally, we want to have stable prices. We might have a little bit of inflation, but we don't want inflation to be out of control. That would be economic stability. Sustained economic growth in an environment where we have full employment and where inflation is stabilized. One of the ways we look at this, one of the ways we judge this in macroeconomics is through a tool called the business cycle. The business cycle shows the normal ups and downs in an economy. It goes up sometimes, it goes down sometimes. And essentially what we're looking at is how the economy fluctuates. Take a look at the graph here. On the horizontal axis, we have time, and on the vertical axis, we have GDP. And then we draw a curve. It goes up, it goes down, it goes up, it goes down, it goes up, it goes down, just like the economy. Each part of the business cycle gets a name. The upward swing is called a recovery. And as long as the economy is in an upward phase, or upward swing, we have a recovery period. At the top of the business cycle, we have the peak. And the bad thing about being at a peak is that you only have one way to go, and that's down. The downward phase is called the recession. And then you hit the bottom, that's called the trough. And the only good thing about being in a trough is you only have one direction to go, and that's back up, and that's another recovery. We measure business cycles from one peak to the next. And business cycles are a useful tool. It shows us that the economy naturally has ups and downs, but there are some problems for us in the business cycle. One of those problems is that the business cycle has different durations of phases. How long a recovery is differs for every business cycle, and how long a recession is varies for each different business cycle. Think of the recession in 2007-2008 versus the Great Depression. So we have a couple of years versus over a decade of recession. So the duration of the phases are different. The depth of the phases are different also. How far down you go or how far up you go varies from business cycle to business cycle. We had a recession in 2001 and people barely realized it because the depth of the recession was so very, very shallow. And then finally we have the dispersion of the business cycle. Not all sectors are affected equally within a business cycle. Some sectors do quite well, some do very, very poorly. So if you're looking at manufacturing versus the service sector, you see very different outcomes. So when we look at macroeconomics, there's all kinds of different tools. These are just the basics, and we'll use these going forward.